So in some ways, the children already gave the sermon, but you're all not getting away that easily. So we are going to open the Word today as we continue, as you saw in the video, our series on counterfeit gods, the things that the world tends to create to counterfeit the things that God desires of us. And the things we're looking at over the month of May from the first chapter of James is our time, which we talked a little bit about last week. We're going to dive more into time as we get through the treasure section as well, because they do coincide. Our talents and then our treasures. This week we're talking about our talents. And again, talents not as in the biblical understanding of money from like the parable of the talents. Talents as in gifting. So we're going to read verses 9 through 12 of James chapter 1. Starting with verse 9, let the lowly brother boast in his exaltation, and the rich in his humiliation, because like a flower of the grass he will pass away. For the sun rises when it's scorching heat and withers the grass. Its flowers fail and its beauty perishes. So also will the rich man fade away in the midst of his pursuits. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, for which God has promised to those who love him. So this is our look as we look through James, because James hits all of these different factors, talking about how as believers we are called to live our life. Now again, a little background of James. This is the half-brother of Jesus, not the disciple. And the one thing that that was to me last week pivotal about James's journey is that James was actually kind of suspect of Jesus's ministry while Jesus was on earth. That James's sanctification really didn't come to pass till he met the resurrected Jesus, which I think if we were all honest with ourselves, that's part of all of our stories as well. That there are some times we doubt, there are some times that kind of festers in us in faith. And James is very open about that. And what James is talking about, this is all kind of post-resurrection and more sanctification life. Martin Luther did not want the book of James in here because James spends some time in chapter 2 and 3 talking about works. And so many people think that the way to Jesus is by works, and that is not what James is saying at all. James is saying that after one claims Jesus is Lord and is living in the gospel, that our time, our talents, and our treasure are to be used for the gospel because of what Jesus has done. So this is an after effect, right? This is the person that comes to know Jesus and then is living this out. And Luther wanted it not in the canonized Bible because he thought that it was maybe people would read it as this is what I need to do to earn salvation. And we know this morning that there's nothing we can do. There's no amount of children's ministry that Lisa can do and leading the kids that can earn her place in heaven. But Lisa knows Jesus as her Lord and Savior. And out of that, she flows the time, the energy, the patience to work with the children of our church. And how do I know that she needs patience? Because some of them are mine and some of them are yours. And so we understand that. And so part of this morning, we're going to talk about really a fun topic, that when a pastor can get up and talk about the talents of their church and the giftings of the church, for the pastor, it's super, super exciting. Not always so for the congregation member. Why do you think that is? Why do you think that this kind of can be brought with a little tribulation and fear when the pastor talks about the gifts of the people of the church? Because I want you to do something. Thank you, Karen. Okay, yes. This is where I get to put just a huge guilt trip on you. And guess what? Next week starts our conversation about money, because that's usually what people's understanding of church is, right? So, no, not so much that, Karen, but why else do you think that, you know, people may engage the conversation about gifting with fear and tribulation? What? Someone give her a high five. Evie, because they don't know that they have them, or they may not know, or they may be confused about it. Let me just start right off the bat that if you claim Jesus Christ as Lord, you have been gifted by the Spirit for the advancement of the church. I could just stop there, but it's only 10:07. That we all have been gifted by the Spirit. Now, for some of you, that might be a new idea. For some of you, maybe you're going, I have never heard of that before. Insert fear here. No. It's a good thing. It's something that we are called to celebrate. And so that's what we're going to look at today. We're going to really break down. It's going to be kind of an information-heavy sermon. So if you are taking notes, I'll try to go slow. If you would like a copy of some of the notes that I talk about, shoot me an email or a text message. I'll get those out to you. But today, we're talking about talents. And again, it's a polarizing conversation because there are some faith traditions, some churches, that kind of use the idea of talents to guilt people into do stuff. To pressure people into do stuff. You know, well, you've been a member of this church this long, and you know what? You've not done much, so you've been gifted by God, so why don't you serve? Because that's what Jesus wanted, right? Jesus wanted us to guilt people into serving the church. No, it's a celebration. It is understanding that God has gifted you, and there are all sorts of talents of the church. One of the only ways the Munster Church, not this August, but next August, is going to celebrate 150 years, is because the people of the church use their gifts. They use their talents. Believe me, if you put it all on the shoulders of the pastor, this thing would have fell away and it would have been game over a long time ago. But it's the people of the church, the people that make up the church and the giftings of the church that make the church thrive with the promise of the Holy Spirit and the work of the gospel. It's all sorts of gifts in this church. So the first thing we have to break down, and here comes the information, okay? You have natural talents and learned abilities, okay? We all do. That covers all of us. We all have natural talents and we all have learned abilities that come into the gifting of the church, right? Some of us are born more extroverted. Some of us are born more introverted. Some of us like people and some of us try to. And all of these things, right? We have to separate these two because the giftings talk about it. Natural talents are abilities that are the part of who you are. They may be artistic talents, intelligent, physical, organization, and so on. There is something that is innate, something that's part of you, something that is built up in you, right? That you just kind of have a natural affinity for certain things. That's a natural talent, and praise God for that. Praise God that He has designed all of us differently. If we just take these six rows, there's all sorts of giftings here. Not one person is the same. If you just look around at the 200-some people in this sanctuary, not one person is the same. And that's a beautiful thing. And it kind of gets broken down. Then we have learned abilities, things we learn over time. And what I want you to understand, the wise man that James is talking about, the wise man understands that his learned ability is from God. Now, why is that a point? Why should the wise man be given credit that he understands that the learned giftings that we're going to talk about, and there's many in the Bible, is a gift of God? What's the danger when we don't look at it like that? If we don't look at our talents as a gift from God, what's the danger? Pride, ego, absolutely. We're going to make it about us. That's how you get superstar pastors. That term alone makes me want to vomit. That any pastor would want to consider themselves a superstar is disgusting, in my opinion. That a learned ability, a gift from God, when we can remain in the place where God is God, I am not. Everything, if God is sovereign, everything is given from God. That means I take no pride in it. Am I excited about it? Absolutely. Do I use it? Of course. Do I grow in it? Of course you do. The Bible tells us so. But the minute we start looking at our gifting or our talents, right? The minute I think that everything that I do is so great because of me is the minute I am in a room with eight elders holding me accountable. That's how churches get in trouble. We got to start this conversation with talents. At the minute we think it's because of how good we are, we've lost it. So you have your natural abilities and you have your learned abilities from God. Learned abilities are a result of an informal or formal education sometimes that God brings us through this understanding, right? I mean, we use the understanding of plumbing last week, right? That we have, you know, plumbers in the world that do good jobs. How do we know? Because he's really busy all the time, right? If he was a bad plumber, no one's going to call him. You know, But there's also a reason why people aren't calling me to fix their pipes, right? Because people know that that's not a gifting of mine. It's a recognized, learned thing. Roger has that. I don't. But have you ever heard Roger sing? Anybody? Yeah. Is he good? You're supposed to raise your hand. Let's affirm our brother. Thank you. Yeah, that was, sorry, Roger. But no, I mean, that's another talent that he has. I mean, a singing plumber. I think that's the commercial. I think that's the tagline. We may be onto something here. But, I mean, you think about two very different sets of skills, right? The plumber and just the angelic voice of Roger Mottman, right? That those are two very different gifts, all given by the same God. Now, some of you are like, well, I would have never thought that Roger's gift for, you know, plumbing would be given from God. Why not? It helps make a living for his family. It's his career area. And if God is sovereign, God has Roger exactly where he's called him to be. So we have to start looking at our gifts and abilities just like that. Our learned abilities, but also the natural gifting that God gives. Identifying your natural talents and learned abilities is crucial in the church. That the Bible calls us to understand what our gifts are. Because not using your gifts, let's use this in a more practical understanding. All of the parents in the room, think about a time that you really got your kid that really kind of expensive toy that they wanted, all right? You get one in your mind, don't get angry, right? But get it in your mind, let it fester, just kidding. And the feeling you get when the kid never plays with it. Now I'm seeing some shaking your head. You know, some of you can relate that you know, maybe you have to work overtime to get it, you know, all of these kind of things. But if we know anything about children's toys, they're kind of cyclical, and the box, more times than not, is more fun than the actual toy. But you put all of this time, all of this love, and they freak out. They love it. They open it up, whether their birthday or whatever, and they're so excited for it. And 2 weeks later, there is dust on it. Because they're not playing with it. Think about God giving that stuff to us. That God has given you gifts and abilities, and there's dust on them, and they're not used. I want to pop that bubble this morning. Us, people that claim to be followers of Jesus, that are not using their giftings, is actually a disrespect to God. Some of you are like, well, those are fighting words. Well, no, they're not. That the Bible talks countlessly in the New Testament about the church using of their gifts, that the church is called to be a church of order, right? Structure of sending the gospel out, not everyone just coming here, but using their gifts. So they're connected, right? Your natural talents, your learned abilities, and then there's the third one, the spiritual gifts. Right? There are spiritual gifts. So you may have something you're good at, that you are a skilled work, that your work, you know, maybe that's your career. That's awesome. You know, natural abilities. So if we're going to use Roger, for example, and I won't use you every week, Roger. This is probably the last one. Probably not. But that's okay. That, you know, Roger has a learned ability of plumbing, a natural ability of singing, but there's also a spiritual gift. Now, we'll go away from Roger because we don't want him to get a big head, but he also has been gifted spiritually along with everybody else that claims Jesus as Lord. That if you claim Jesus, then there is a spiritual gift, which is a God-given ability of a particular spiritual nature or spiritual purpose. They may coincide with your natural gift and abilities, and they may not. Because the cool thing is God and we are not. And he designs it that way. For example, a person may be born with an aptitude for teaching, right? I think we have a brand new teacher right over here, right? Yeah, Mrs. Schleicher. And so that is something that she has learned, she's worked through, and that is exciting. And maybe that person goes to the university and learns the practical ins and outs of teaching, does the field work, gets the diploma. This gives direction and boundaries for the natural talent being used. But maybe after that person's conversion and study of the scriptures, they discover that they have the spiritual gift of teaching. something that is more natural, more of their natural talent and ability, and God uses it. But what happens if they also learn they have the gift of hospitality? That it might not just be because I'm a teacher, my spiritual gift is teaching. Sometimes it's not. And by studying the scriptures, we learn more and more about what those gifts are. And we're going to go over those this morning. So our spiritual gifts, two words, spiritual and gifts. They occur together as a phrase only once in the Greek text in Romans 1:11, where it does not seem to be referring to the gifts given by the Spirit, but it has to do with spiritual benefit. Again, this is post-salvation. This isn't use your gifts, get into heaven. This is you're going to heaven, so use your gifts. Clear difference, right? Spiritual gifts put together, Romans tell us about being a living sacrifice, a spiritual benefit for you as an individual, but more importantly, for the church. So we have these kind of a table that the New Testament has set up for giftings. 1 Corinthians 12 gives us the teaching gifts, right? You have the gift of being an apostle, of being a teacher, having the gift of knowledge, a gift of prophecy. We're going to talk about that in a minute. The gift of wisdom. Then you also have the miraculous gifts, the gift of faith, the gift of healing, the gift of miracles, distinguishing between spirits, diversity of languages. These are all gifts that are given to be in right order in the scripture. Then there are service gifts. There's a gift of leadership, administration, showing mercy, serving, giving. So there is a list that is compiled in Corinthians, a list that is compiled in the book of Romans, Ephesians, and 1 Peter. So if you're writing in your notes, 1 Corinthians 12, Romans 12, Ephesians 4, and 1 Peter 4 all talk about the different giftings. And those are the giftings that the Spirit brings us into. Now, not one person has all the gifts. That's not how that works, because in the letter of Corinthians, Paul talks about the body of Christ. The body is made up of different parts, so are people made up of different gifts. And the knee can't say to the elbow, or the elbow can't say to the neck, I don't need you. All the gifts work together for God's glory and for the advancement of the gospel. So if you are utilizing your gifts to bring God glory and to advance the gospel, way to go. Keep it up. If you are utilizing the gifts because you get a good feeling out of it, because people think you should, right? Or so it's just something that can keep people spiritually busy, time out. Let's take a refresher course. If your gifts are not used to advance the gospel and to not give God glory, then maybe they're not gifts of the Spirit. And so many times, especially with how fast-paced the world is, we just want to throw these gifts at different people and have them use them. Let's just get the church busy. Let's have all of these Bible studies. Let's do all of these things and have all of these programs. Programs are not spiritual gifts. Programs are what happens when people use their gifts in a common vision of a church. When Carrie and I were in the call process for this church, one of the things I loved is that there was a community bent, that this church, you know, kind of said, we are going to be a community church, I don't know how many years ago, and that was really exciting for us. It's really exciting to see in our GEMS program, we have kids that don't go to church. Bible studies, both men and women, there are people that don't necessarily have church backgrounds that are there. Friends, that's what it's all about. If all we're doing is self-serving, this isn't a buffet. This is the gospel. We're supposed to go and spread the gospel using our gifts. So a couple truths about talents. God decides how they're distributed and who gets them. Every individual has his or her allotted proportion and endowment of God in that gifting. So it's not like every day you could be like, well, no, I think my gift today is prophecy. And then the next day, I think my gift is teaching. No. That's not how that works. God gives those gifts and grows people in them in their sanctification. Big theological term. What does it mean? That means as you grow in your faith after salvation, after you've recognized and professed that Jesus is Lord. Some may have more than one gift. That's okay. Some may have more than one. That's awesome. And don't ever look at it as like, man, I only have the gift of mercy. Stop. That's a huge gift, right? That's an amazing gift. The idea, especially in our culture, where everyone wants their pound of flesh, the gift of mercy, having that is a great thing. To be able to show mercy to people in times of need is a wonderful thing. And again, if we're disappointed by it, that means we don't trust our Savior. We don't trust the Spirit giving it to us. In any local church, it is possible that there will be several people with the same gifting. Totally fine. That the gifts are abundant. That we all, if we are in Christ, we are in those gifts. The scriptures kind of outline what those are. That, in order to have a spiritual gift, you have to claim Jesus as Lord. It doesn't work otherwise. You know, you can't say, I'm a Buddhist, and so I'm going to prophesy the Christian scriptures. It doesn't work, right? That a Christian belief, the gifts are given. One of the major problems in the church is the neglecting of the gifts, people that want gifts for their glory, or, and I apologize ahead of time if this stings, if we think we're too busy to use them. Again, we are all called to give back to the church. We're all called to grow the church. We're all called to advance the gospel. Not one person here can say, no, I'm going to take a rest from the gospel. I just changed jobs, or I just went through a life circumstance, or I just. No. Those are all selfish excuses. The gospel is advanced no matter what, because that's the bride of Christ. That is Christ's church, is the advancement of the gospel. Now, the role and purpose, we've talked a little bit about that, but all the gifts are appointed by God. The role and purpose of gifts is to, like we said, glorify God, advance the gospel, and to grow in them. So many times, people more towards the latter part of their lives, if they've been in church, are like, I know everything I need to know about blank. Stop. No, you haven't. That's not a thing. We will never reach a spiritual mountaintop because that's called perfection, and we'll never be that until we're in the face of perfection in heaven with Jesus Christ. But until that time, we use our talents, we use our gifts. But one thing we have to be careful of is using our gifts over people, not with people. You want to see how that truly hurts a church? Read the book of Timothy, read the book of Corinthians. Because in that time, in that space, Paul was noting that, you know what? Mike had the gift of proclamation with music. And every week, this is not, you are the exact opposite of this, by the way, but what would have been happening is, I have the microphone, no one else does. That understanding was going on in Corinth. That I have this gift, so I'm better than you. Or, you know what, I've been walking in my gift, so therefore I'm a stronger and better Christian than you are. All of that is ego. And is that not the counterfeit? That we're all been gifted. We all have our talents. And we're going to talk about practical ways of learning what those are, whether you've been a believer a week or you've been a believer for 80 years. We're going to talk about that in a minute. We're going to wrap up with that. But what's the counterfeit? It's very, very, very small line. Doing it for God's glory or doing it for our ego. Now, some of you may be looking at it going, no, there's a chasm between there. I know exactly, but you know, my Bible study is so good. Everybody should come to that for God's glory. No, that's an egotistical statement, and that can tear a church apart. Oh, you don't go to that Bible study, so I don't know what that says about your walk with the Lord. Oh, that happened all the time in Corinth. That happened all the time in Ephesus and Timothy, right? They were placing gifts over other people. But we have this kind of popular chapter. You know, some of you actually may have used it in your wedding. I don't want to pop that bubble. I'm sure that was a beautiful day for you. But that was that idea of 1 Corinthians 13. That had nothing to do with the love between a man and a woman. It had everything to do with how the church loves its own, how the church loves the gospel. And what it says is, if I have faith and I have gifts, I need to do them in love. Why? Because the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. No greater love than this, that one that lays down their life for a friend. Everything Christ did was rooted in love. Every gifting we have in the church should be rooted in love. And you've been given elders and deacons to oversee that. That's a whole nother sermon series that we'll get to, I'm sure. But everything that the church does is to be directed by God, not one person or one group or one Bible study or one family last name or anything. It should be all done for the glory of God, done in love. If I speak in tongues of men and of angels, talking about gifts, but I have not loved, I'm just a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have prophetic powers and understand all the mysteries of all knowledge, and if I have all faith as to move mountains, but I have not loved, I am nothing. If I give all that I have and deliver my body to be burned, but I have not loved, I gain nothing. So friends, a couple final questions. A, do you know what your spiritual gifts are? Now, spiritual gifts, something that you definitely can feel, that are definitely confirmed by spiritual oversight. Accountability partner, a parent, if the parent is in Christ, they can confirm your gift in you, right? A mentor, a pastor, the elders, someone that has kind of a, again, you can't go to someone who doesn't know Jesus to say, can you confirm a gift given by Jesus? It doesn't work that way. But the first question is, do you know what your gifts are? Second one, if you do, are you living in them? And that's a long answer. That answer could be very, very complicated. And that's okay, because life can be very, very complicated. And you know what? Timing and seasons of life, all of those things play a part in that. But if you know your gift and you're not using it, that final question comes, why? Why are you not? What's stopping you? Fear? Immaturity? Fear, so many other reasons why we give for not doing it. But God says, I will be with you when you do that, and do it rooted in love. Why? Because love never ends, verse 8 of 1 Corinthians 15. As for prophecies, at some point they're going to cease. As for tongues, they're going to stop. As for knowledge, it'll pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when Jesus comes, the partial will pass away. And I love this. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. Some of you, your wives may say you still do that. But when I became a man, I gave up my childish ways. Childish ways is to make excuses. As adults in faith, we don't. We own it. If we sin, we confess. If we have a gift, we use it. And we love and forgive those around us. That's how the gifts continue. So, do you know your gift? If you don't, how do you find that out? Well, here at Munster Church, we have made an opportunity for you that starting, actually, it's already live. If you go on our website, munster.church or munsterchurch.org, they go to both to our website. On that main bar is a spiritual gift assessment. Free to take. You just have to fill out kind of your information, your email, and all of that, and then you take it. It's 100 questions, right? If you take it seriously, it'll take you about 17 minutes. And we don't have our app up and running yet. That'll come in a couple weeks, and it will be available on that. But for now, it's on our website. If you do not have, I don't want to say if you do not have access to the internet, because that's almost not a thing. But if you don't want to do it online, that is fine. Email the church office. We will send you a copy. Sorry, if you're not going to do that, you're probably not going to email either. If you want to come and pick up a paper copy, we will make one. I think that's possible. No, it is. And we will get that for you. But the one thing, when you fill it out, it will give you kind of that list I gave you of giftings. It will kind of rank your strongest gifts, your primary gifts, your secondary gifts, and maybe gifts later to come. Now, the cool thing is, part of my degree is I've kind of learned how to help people walk through that and disciple them through that. So if you have questions about those, some of you are going to read that and you're going to go, that's exactly that. Yep, I get that. Okay, walk in it. If some of you are like, I have no idea how to read this data, let's make a time to have a cup of coffee and talk about it. It is one of my favorite things to do when people understand their giftings and go, this is how I can walk in them. Why? Because it makes my job a lot easier. And so it's one of those things that when we learn what our gifts are, we know how we can best serve the Lord. But when you know what your gift is, there's almost a burden of knowledge, isn't there? Because if I know what my gift is, then I need to use it. And that gift is going to be rooted in sharing the gospel, is going to be rooted in love. About the use of gifts, and I use this to close. So we all got that on the website. If you don't, call the church office, write a hand letter, I'll get it in 2 weeks, and send it back, or come and we'll try to print off some for you. But about their gifts, they are to be used with diligence, cheerfulness, and faithfulness. What does this mean? Fine, I'll be an elder. No, please don't do that. Fine, I'll go to Bible study. I'll help our kids. Gosh, no. They are to be used with diligence, cheerfulness, and faithfulness. If those are not evident, let's have a conversation. They are to be used in order and in fitting ways. Well, I have this gift, and I'm going to use it to kind of circumvent the leadership of this church and start my own thing. No. That God has called this church to have a vision, and we use our gifts according to that vision. Why? Because you have a leadership that is unified around it. That the church is to be unified and in right order. When the leaders of the church are at each other's throats, no one should be using their gifts because it's all going to go awry. But I guarantee you, folks, that we have unity in this church, that the leadership is unified. It was one of the most attractive things for Carrie and I to engage this call. Does that mean you all agree? No, we're all people, right? But we are unified. We know where we're going. We're going to love God always and to love people, and all of our gifts go toward that. And you can't really say, well, that we don't follow that. Well, we do, because that's Matthew 28 in the Bible. Although given by God, how and when they are used is under the direction and control of the church, right? So this also, and this is a common thing that people get tripped up on. Well, I feel called to lead a Bible study. Well, we don't know if this is the right season of that church. Well, I don't like you, and I'm going to leave. How is any of that conversation God-honoring? One of the best things that I get to have conversations with, when people come to me with ministry ideas, I say, go find three other people. Why three? Because it's biblical. I don't know. But go find three people and all get excited to build that. And how does that fit in our vision? And let's see how that's implemented. And then when that homework is done, when that excitement is there, and when it's clearly in right order, understood what that's going to be, friends, it's a lot easier for the elders to look over that and go, this is awesome. But so many people just want to go pew, 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 and shoot from the hip. Nothing about spiritual gifts is improv. None about spiritual gifts is to shoot off the cuff. God, why would God gift his people to do that? He gifts the church for his glory and for the advancement of the gospel. The verbal content expressed in their use will express genuine acknowledgement of the deity of Christ. I want to stop and take 30 seconds on this one. There is a new understanding coming out of a seminary in New York, where you have the president of that seminary saying, I am a full-fledged Christian, but I deny the divinity of Christ, the actual resurrection, and that the crucifixion probably didn't happen. Friends, let me tell you, that's not Christianity. That a Christian is defined by those three marks in the actual resurrection, the physical resurrection. How do we know? Because Paul wrote that. But there is this mindset that I can be a Christian, I can go to heaven when I die, but I deny the divinity of Christ. Wrong. That is a lie from the pit of hell. Bible is very clear on that. And why? And his gifts, the gifts that God gives, are used for that. So you can't, that's like someone who believes in maybe the Mormon faith, they can't lead a Christian Bible study. It doesn't work. That's like asking a sea bass to teach baseball. It doesn't make sense, right? It does not work. The gifts are used for the good of the church. We've already talked about that. The possession of a specific gift should never be the cause of personal pride, boasting, or another person's harm. You want to know how that goes in a church? Read Corinthians, read Timothy. And I love this last one. The possession of the gift does not provide an excuse for disobeying God's commands. God, I'm following your gifts. I don't need to follow your law. No. Because obviously if you're loving God and loving people, you're going to follow the law. Your gifts are going to coincide with that. We've talked a lot about the objectivity of gifts. Why? Because that's the best for the church. Because if we all just think that it's all how our minds create all of it, let's call a spade, friends. The church would be a nightmare. That everything is laid out the way God wants it to be laid out. And it's all about sacrifice and love for the glory of God and the advancement of the gospel. If your gifting is not rooted in that, it is not a spiritual gift. Now, we all have been gifted some way or the other. My hope and my prayer is that when maybe you take that assessment online, maybe you confirm those gifts with a group of trusted individuals, that we're going to get to work. Work's already happening. The gospel is being proclaimed and being advanced. Look at Europe and China and all those places. Let the same be said here for a Long Ridge Road. That people would know Munster Church as a loving people, right? That people would be able to say, you know what? I may not fully believe what Munster Church believes, but you know what? Those people are kind. I want to hang out with those people. That's a start. And that only happens when we are all rooted and growing in our gifts. No gimmicks, no obligations, all for the gospel. Next week, we're going to translate into the treasure part of that. And friends, that is more than just money. So don't roll your eyes and say, oh, this is just Pastor Jim talking on behalf of the leadership to get more money. No. We're not even going to start there. You know what? We're not even going to end there. That's only one part of the discussion. More to come on that next.